Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Digital Resilience. Is Your Company Ready for the Next Cyber Threat? By Ray A. Rothrock. Foreword by Richard A. Clark. Narrated by Chris Sorensen. Foreword. The White House, Pentagon, State Department, NSA, an Iranian nuclear plant unconnected to the internet, and numerous large banks and corporations have been successfully hacked. Almost any network can be. The goal of network owners and operators should not be just to prevent unauthorized penetration. That goal is almost too ambitious to be realized. In addition to seeking to exclude malicious actors, network operators should seek a more attainable goal: to be resilient under attack. Resilient networks are those that quickly identify and limit the activities of unauthorized actors. They are networks that are architected to minimize the potential for damage. Most important, they are characterized by an ability to resume essential operations quickly after sustaining a disabling attack. As cyber threats become more persistent, more sophisticated, and more pernicious, we must take a proactive approach to achieving this digital resilience. Making this pursuit more difficult, the topography of the threat landscape is becoming increasingly diverse and complex, with new and unique malware popping up every day. On May 12, 2017 at 7:44 a.m. UTC, a lone computer in Southeast Asia had its contents encrypted by the WannaCry ransomware. 30 minutes later, WannaCry had reached Latin America, and by 10:05 a.m., the malware had its first victims in Europe. Within a single day, it had infected over 230,000 computers globally, but was stopped in its tracks 2 days later by a cybersecurity researcher who discovered a kill switch in the WannaCry code. In this very brief period of time, countless major organizations and multinational firms had their operations interrupted, perhaps the most notable of which were a few hospitals of the UK's National Health Service. They were forced to turn away patients as their MRI machines and other equipment were rendered inoperable, thus showing the world a mechanism whereby computer code may indirectly lead to the deaths of innocent civilians. WannaCry could have been far worse had it not been for the kill switch that was hidden away in the code, and the cybersecurity community is already bracing for the next iteration of a similar ransomware that doesn't include one. This particular attack was indiscriminate in that it infected any device that was vulnerable. However, large firms with valuable information are now being increasingly targeted with advanced attacks that are tailored to their unique systems. Refer to Chapter 1 for the Target Cyber Attack circa 2013. These attacks, although less pervasive, are much more effective and invite a more comprehensive approach to cybersecurity. Companies need to be resilient and adapt because at some point, they will have to recover from one. It is not a question of if, but when. The fundamental truth that C-suite executives must acknowledge in today's digital ecosystem is that no company, no organization, and no network is impenetrable. We must view our efforts toward engineering networks with the assumption that, to some extent, they will get in and attempt to acquire what they want. It's up to the cybersecurity professionals to allow this assumption to inform their network design and shape subsequent decisions about what cybersecurity tools are eventually implemented. In this way, it's critical to understand that a dollar spent on efforts to preemptively mitigate the damage is money better spent than a dollar spent trying to prevent network penetration altogether. Companies often focus far too much on prevention rather than, for instance, malware containment or implementing robust means of data recovery. I believe much of these misguided efforts can be attributed to a lack of cybersecurity understanding in the boardroom. Even today, after numerous high-profile attacks have received extensive news coverage, one would think that the issue is sufficiently salient for every firm to take concrete steps toward protecting itself. Yet it seems that many board members of major companies are painfully unaware of the importance of securing their networks, or of the risks and costs, both tangible and intangible, that are realized after a cyber attack. Companies may lose their customers' trust, diminish their brand's image, or incur costs that significantly reduce their bottom line. These ramifications can even affect mergers and acquisitions. For example, in 2016, a massive data breach caused a $350 million decrease in Yahoo's selling price to Verizon. Our job as practitioners in the industry is to explain these issues to the decision makers in a clear manner to cultivate a common understanding of digital resilience and its importance. Cybersecurity must also increasingly be seen as an integral part of the business strategy of today's firms, as a breach has a substantial financial impact on the business that may prevent it from achieving its other goals. Whether it's legal costs to compensate customers for having their personal information stolen, or foregone revenue of products you didn't sell because the schematics were stolen and the product copied elsewhere, a data breach can be far more expensive than people generally realize. Too often, security is viewed as something peripheral to the organization, but we must all make an effort to bring it into the fold, under the umbrella of the C-suite. Our security professionals must have a seat at the table, because a significant portion of the business's continued success rides on their performance. This audiobook discusses one of the most important issues of our time, and it will only become increasingly important as time goes on. Ray outlines the challenges of cybersecurity with a litany of real-world examples of high-profile attacks, looking at what each organization got right and what they got wrong. However, what I like most about this audiobook is the explanation of technical topics in a manner accessible to the average person who has no background in the fundamentals of computer science or network engineering. By describing these different systems and issues in plain English, Ray is increasing the common person's fluency of cyberspace discourse, which will certainly help the industry as a whole down the road. It's imperative that the public develops an educational foundation of what all of this means, so that a cyber attack is no longer viewed as an enigmatic occurrence that only affects people other than oneself. By listening to this audiobook, you'll develop a much greater understanding of the nature of these issues. You'll learn what digital resiliency is and how to create it. You'll learn the technical fundamentals of networks, how they operate, and why the distributed nature of the internet leaves so many networks vulnerable to attack. You'll also grasp the true inevitability of a successful attack on your own network and learn why it's so important to prepare yourself for that moment. Most important, Ray delineates many different actions that you can take today to implement safeguards for different threats. He illuminates specific actionable items to employ in the workplace and boardroom, and describes how these actions can instill a better sense of cyber risk among the decision makers at your firm. America proved after Pearl Harbor, after the launch of Sputnik and following 9/11, that it was a resilient nation. Unfortunately, today, America's networks are not resilient. This important audiobook, written by one of the nation's most recognized experts in cybersecurity, is about how we can make America's networks, and those of others, resilient in the face of the inevitable attack that succeeds in penetrating the porous perimeter. As I said in my book, Cyber War, in 2010, cyberspace is the new frontier within which the wars of the future will be fought. Whether between nation-states or between private sector companies and hackers, the effects of ongoing campaigns in this theater will reverberate throughout all of society, eventually affecting us all. In this new reality, digital resilience means survival. Richard A. Clark. Chapter 1. Intensively Networked. Why resilience is the only rational cybersecurity choice. November 30th, 2013. From offices in Bangalore, India, employees of the Silicon Valley security firm FireEye alerted Minneapolis-based Target that they had detected evidence of a security breach of Target's digital network. By this time, the U.S. retailer, second only to Walmart in size, had been a FireEye client for about 6 months, having hired the company for $1.6 million to create a state-of-the-art network security system. The 2013 attack against Target was one of more than 3,000 that year, so cyber attacks are far from unusual. In fact, in 2016, the Ponemon Institute, which conducts independent research on privacy, data protection, and information security policy, looked at the likelihood of a company having one or more data breach occurrences in the next 24 months, and concluded that each of the 383 companies it surveyed had a 26% probability of a material data breach involving 10,000 lost or stolen records. Put another way, over the long term, the nature of the threat against the digital network of your business is defined by two facts. Number one, breaches are, by their nature, highly probable occurrences, so probable that over the long term they can be deemed inevitable. Breaches will happen. Breaches will happen to you. Number two, breaches are, by their nature, costly in time, worry, and reputation. Answering the call to action. The call to action is clear. We must protect ourselves and our enterprises. The problem is that no means of protection is bulletproof. It is not enough to erect a firewall around the firm's digital infrastructure, issue anti-malware software to all hands, pronounce your enterprise secure, and walk away. Such passive, static security measures are necessary, but they are not sufficient. In Chapter 3, we will review the most effective and cost-effective strategies and devices for securing our networks. We must note, however, and always bear in mind that security alone offers no silver bullet. All security approaches are inherently and inevitably flawed because the vulnerabilities of digital connection are inherent and inevitable. They are the price of opening ourselves to the opportunities of connection. Once we accept the risk-reward trade-off of digital connectivity, our next step is to survive and even thrive under attack. Digital security is an incomplete answer. Digital resilience completes the answer. As a concept, digital resilience is relatively new, but only because digital technology is relatively new and network digital technology is even newer. The fact is that digital resilience is a subset of resilience, which is a characteristic of biological, ecological, social, national, and institutional systems that have survived and thrived, some of them since time immemorial. Whereas digital security is about security, digital resilience is about how you do business in today's intensively interconnected environment. It is not confined to the realm of IT specialists, but is a whole business strategy. The Target attack. What a failure of resilience looks like. Only two things make the 2013 attack on Target unusual: its magnitude, 70 million customers became victims, and the amount and detail of insight we have gained from it. While the Equifax data breach, which took place during May through July 2017 but was not reported until September 2017, affected at least twice as many victims, 145.5 million American consumers, close to half the U.S. population, we don't as yet have sufficient information to create a definitively illuminating narrative. The Target attack reveals the severe limits of conventional digital security. More important, it is a call to move beyond these limits. The numbers make it clear that attack is virtually inevitable. We need something more than the current state-of-the-art in digital security. It is true that most private and public sector leaders agree on the necessity of making preparations for survival under cyber attack. All sophisticated businesses have active disaster recovery plans, DRP, and business continuity plans, BCP. They understand that having an emergency plan for a crisis is essential. But both DRPs and BCPs are very different from a cyber recovery plan. The purpose of this audiobook is to persuade managers, C-suite executives, and boards of directors that the default environment in which their highly connected businesses, institutions, and government agencies operate is in crisis. Connectivity creates both frictionless business opportunity and frictionless vulnerability to attack. This is today's default situation. Mere survival is not a sufficiently ambitious objective. Intensively connected enterprises need to thrive in high-risk environments and even under attack. Thriving under attack is not a radical proposal. It is a function of digital resilience. As defined very ably by Andrew Zolli and Anne-Marie Healy, resilience is the capacity of a system, enterprise, or a person to maintain its core purpose and integrity in the face of dramatically changed circumstances. The chapters that follow are about applying the concept and quality of resilience specifically to digital networks. Before we get to these chapters, however, let us take a close-up look at what happened to a network whose operators failed to make it resilient. The target attack, breach, and data theft, one of about 3,000 that year, is representative of today's digital business environment. It is also an event about which we have an abundance of information. On March 26, 2014, John Mulligan, Executive President and Chief Financial Officer of Target Corporation, testified before the Senate Committee on Commerce, Science, and Transportation. His unenviable task was to explain why and how the credit card data of 40 million of his company's customers had been stolen. It appears that intruders entered our system on November 12, 2013, he testified. With the benefit of hindsight and new information, we are now asking hard questions regarding the judgments that were made at that time and assessing whether different judgments may have led to different outcomes. Without doubt, the first hard question is why, having been alerted by Bangalore on November 30, 2013, Target's Minneapolis-based Security Operations Center did exactly nothing. Nothing. The next question is why, after a second alert was sent on December 2nd, they also did nothing. Target did not even begin an internal investigation until December 12th, when the retailer was notified by the Justice Department of suspicious activity involving payment cards used at Target stores. Target personnel met with the DOJ and the Secret Service on December 13th, hired an outside team of experts to lead a thorough forensic investigation on December 14th, and on December 15th, confirmed that criminals had infiltrated our system, installed malware on our point-of-sale network, and potentially stolen guest payment card data. That same day, we removed the malware from virtually all registers in our U.S. stores. By this time, records affecting 70 million customers had been stolen. Data for 40 million debit and credit cards, plus the personally identifiable information, PI, of those customers, in addition to 30 million others whose credit card data was not stolen. For 40 to 70 million Target customers, there were the ugly consequences of identity theft. Unauthorized charges to sort out, inability to access credit, endless phone calls to credit reporting agencies, getting blindsided by fraudulent credit and loan applications, and no way to know when and where the ripples created by compromised PI would end. For Target, the gross expense created by the breach during 2013 to 2014 was reported as $252 million. Insurance compensation reduced this to $162 million, and tax deductions brought it down to $105 million. Nevertheless, the company's profits fell 46% in its fourth fiscal quarter of 2013 and were down by more than a third for all of 2013. More than 140 lawsuits from customers and financial institutions rolled in. In March 2015, Target settled a class action suit brought by customers for $10 million. In August, Target settled with Visa for $67 million, and in December, the company settled with several banks, whose credit cards were compromised, for $39 million in damages. Both Target CIO Beth Jacob and CEO Greg Steinhafel resigned following the breach. Federal and state authorities have threatened fines and other penalties. Beyond all this, there was the damage to the Target brand and reputation, a hit difficult to measure. We are asking hard questions about whether we could have taken different actions before the breach was discovered that would have resulted in different outcomes, Mulligan told the senators. In particular, we are focused on what information we had that could have alerted us to the breach earlier. There is an answer to this. An earlier alert would have made no difference. Two reasons. First, Target made no response to the two alerts it did receive. There is no compelling reason to believe it would have responded to an alert received earlier. Second, the November 30th alert came after the network had been infiltrated but before the data was being exfiltrated. The theft itself started on December 2nd, the date of the second alert. Nurtured on pop culture images of wired-in cyber prodigies gone over to the dark side, the uninformed picture hackers as superhuman geniuses and assume they move with infinite stealth and at great speed. Those who possess even basic knowledge of the complexity of large digital networks, however, know that infiltrating a network, finding what you want to take, and then exfiltrating that material, which typically amounts to huge quantities of data, takes time. Days, weeks, sometimes months. As far as can be determined, exfiltration from Target did not begin until December 2nd and continued for nearly 2 weeks. The process was painstaking. The malware automatically sent data to three different U.S.-based staging points, servers located in Ashburn, Virginia, Provo, Utah, and Los Angeles, California, active only between 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. Central Standard Time, probably to reduce the chances that the outflow would be detected by burying it in the massive volume of normal workday traffic. From the U.S. staging points, the data was sent to vpsville.ru, a Moscow-based web hosting service which operates openly. The company's spokesman, Alexander Kiva, later unapologetically explained that the company has far too many clients to effectively monitor. Action item. There is no bulletproof protection against cyber attack. Digital security is mandatory but not sufficient. In addition to digital security, understand, embrace, and implement digital resilience as a strategy for surviving and thriving in an inherently insecure digital environment. Advanced persistent threat. The enemy within. Far from being smash-and-grab affairs, most meaningful breaches take time. Indeed, an entire category of breach is categorized as an advanced persistent threat, APT, a network attack in which the intruder not only gains access to the network, but remains active in it for a long period of time. To date, the most spectacular documented APT was that of APT-1, which was exposed in a February 2013 report by the Mandiant Security Company. APT-1 is believed to be the Second Bureau of China's People's Liberation Army, PLA, General Staff Department's GSD, Third Department. Since 2006, APT-1 compromised 141 companies spanning 20 major industries, most of them U.S.-based. It maintained access to victim networks for an average of 356 days. The longest span was 1,764 days of continuous network access, 4 years and 10 months. On the one hand, the persistence of the advanced persistent threat is truly appalling. On the other hand, the takeaway lesson of the APT is that the most serious and destructive attacks provide us with a great deal of time to discover them, If we pay attention and if we know our own networks both comprehensively and intimately. But few enterprises pay enough attention, and even fewer know much of anything about the networks they operate. APT-1 was a highly crafted military operation backed by the resources of the government of the world's most populous nation. As for the level of skill required to pull off the target breach, however, Jim Walter, director of threat intelligence operations at the McAfee security firm, called the malware that was used absolutely unsophisticated and uninteresting. Two of its main moving parts were off-the-shelf malware, Citadel and Captosha, both available for purchase on underground or undergroundish websites well known to cybercriminals. The first was used to steal credentials enabling the attackers to enter the target system. The second was used to steal credit card information of customers who swiped their cards at the store's cash registers. Both APT-1 and the target breach were long present in the networks they attacked. The significance of this is that they were discoverable if the operators of the networks under attack had possessed better, fuller knowledge of those networks. Action item. Truly destructive network breaches are not smash-and-grab attacks. A successful breach is better described and understood as a chronic infection rather than a transitory attack, as espionage and embezzlement rather than burglary, as an invasion and occupation rather than a hit-and-run raid. An intruder can live and operate in your network for hours, days, weeks, years. Detecting and neutralizing a breach begins by gaining complete and comprehensive knowledge of your networks and their connections. Take steps to get this knowledge. Anatomy of a run-of-the-mill exploit. Although spectacularly successful, the target breach was a run-of-the-mill cyber exploit. That means two things. First, it was containable, if not stoppable, which is true of the vast majority of cyber attacks. Second, it was the kind of attack likely to hit anyone who runs any digitally connected business. In other words, anyone who runs just about any business today. Using research from Erato Labs and the SANS Institute, we can actually trace the likely steps the attackers took. It is worth tracing because some variation of the target attack has likely been, is being, or will be aimed at your business. Casing the caper. Retail companies deal with retail customers, but they also interact with an array of B2B vendors. Often these vendors are given privileged access to networks and data, especially for bidding and billing purposes. A simple Google search would have revealed to the attackers a wealth of information about targets' vendors. Among these was Fazio Mechanical, a Sharpsburg, Pennsylvania-based refrigeration systems contractor that frequently served Target. Additional research could also have turned up, on a Microsoft website, a case study describing how Target used Microsoft System Center Configuration Manager, SCCM, to automatically update and security patch much of its software infrastructure, including the software for its POS, point-of-sale system, the system communicating with its retail checkout counter card readers. Without so much as having to glance away from their computer monitors or committing any crime, the attackers could have first found a means of hijacking the credentials that could get them into Target's network, and second, obtained a remarkably detailed picture of the retailer's POS system. Phishing for an entrance. The attackers launched an email phishing attack against Target's vendors, such as Fazio Mechanical, which were likely to have privileged access to Target's networks. A phishing email masquerades as a message from some trusted entity, a bank for example, and may trick the recipient into revealing confidential information or clicking on a seemingly legitimate attachment that executes an invasion. In the Target case, someone at Fazio innocently clicked on an email attachment that opened a malware program which infected Fazio's networks and the computers on it. Against Fazio, it is thought that the Target attackers used Citadel, an off-the-shelf password-stealing bot developed by cybercriminals from an older item of malware called Zeus. A Trojan horse used to invade a computer by duping the victim into opening an attachment, Zeus surfaced in 2007. Both Citadel and Zeus are available for sale on black market hacker websites. Stealing credentials. Having obtained from Fazio the credentials needed to enter Target's network via a vendor portal, the attackers let themselves in. One of the things you need to know about your network is that it is only as secure as the networks with which it connects. Vulnerability in a vendor's network can bring you down. What Target didn't know about its network included what it didn't know about its vendor's networks. Gaining access. Because Fazio Mechanical bid and billed Target electronically, it was connected to Target's Ariba billing system web application, to partners online, Target's project management and contract submission system, and to a property development zone web app. None of these was a wide-open front door to Target's systems, but the connections enabled the attackers to upload a nefarious script called a web shell, which is a backdoor through which the attackers could both upload files and execute high-level operating system commands within Target's system. Finding the money. As any burglar knows, getting in is only half the heist. Once inside, you have to find the merchandise. With access to Target's operating system, the intruders were able to search the Active Directory. What they were looking for were databases related to credit, debit cards. Ultimately, these consisted of files with customers' personally identifiable information, PI, and files related to POS devices, the card readers at the checkout counters. Having identified these two targets in the Active Directory, the attackers were able to obtain the IP addresses needed to access both the PI files, turned out there were about 70 million of them, and the POS devices. Getting the privileges. Possessing the necessary IP addresses is not sufficient to get you into those addresses. The attackers needed domain admin privileges, which they obtained, it is believed, by using a technique that is familiar to hackers: pass the hash. When a legitimate admin logs into the Active Directory using her credentials, a Windows computer generates a token called an NT hash. The token, which replaces the user's password, lives in the computer's memory and vanishes when the computer is rebooted. But servers are rarely rebooted, and so valid NT hash tokens litter the system's memory. An attacker simply needs to dig into the machine memory in order to pass the hash and thereby obtain admin privileges. Opening a new account. With domain admin privileges in hand, the attackers were now empowered to create their very own domain admin account, just as if they were trusted Target employees. At least as long as the legitimate admin, whose token they had purloined, did not change her password. Passwords, the intruders knew, are not frequently changed. The attackers made up a username, best1_user, which looked a lot like any existing legitimate username. No one at Target red flagged it, and best1_user served the attackers for more than 2 months. Plenty long enough to infiltrate the Target system, to probe it, and to commandeer the computers they needed in order to exfiltrate the credit card data they were after. Overcoming last-ditch network defenses. Even though Target's Minneapolis-based security team had failed twice to act on the warnings it received, the company's network was hardly defenseless. There were firewalls as well as other good security measures that remained obstacles to access and to infiltration, let alone to the exfiltration of masses of data. Getting around a firewall? As it turns out, there's an app for that. It is off-the-shelf, perfectly legitimate, and openly available online. Called Angry IP Scanner, it is billed as a fast and friendly network scanner. Requires no installation, can be copied, and can be used anywhere. It pings a network's IP addresses to see which ones are alive, and if the user wishes, it will resolve all the necessary network information, host name, MAC addresses, ports, and much more. Using this information, the attackers employ an innocuous port forwarding utility to circumvent firewall rules. They did not break through the firewall, they tunneled under it. Having defeated the firewall, the attackers used standard Microsoft Windows network utilities, PSExec, and a remote desktop protocol tool to enable the remote running of processes on various target machines. They also made use of another Microsoft program, Orchestrator, a workflow management tool that allows IT managers to automate creation, monitoring, and deployment of resources across a company's systems. Orchestrator not only gave the attackers the look of legitimate users, it established the persistence of access that gave the intruders time to infiltrate the system, identify and take what they wanted, and then exfiltrate these masses of data. Getting the pie. The first files exfiltrated were those containing the pie of 70 million target customers. But this wasn't the loot the attackers were after. They wanted the credit cards, the data they could sell to their customers who would use it to clone cards Target's customers had swiped at Target cash registers. Because Target adhered to the Payment Card Industry Data Security Standard, PCI DSS, credit card details were not available in the same files or even on the same servers that held the PI data. PCI compliance could not prevent the breach, but it did delay the attackers. Had they been less focused, the intruders might have given up after having merely stolen the identities of some 70 million human beings. Installing Captosha. Having discovered that they could not extract usable credit card information from the PI data, the attackers turned next to their off-the-shelf Captosha malware, which is memory-scraping software uploaded into POS devices, checkout counter credit card readers, to capture credit and debit card data. Pretty slick. The only catch is that Captosha needed to be installed on Target's POS devices. The attackers therefore had to turn back to hijacking more devices, this time exploiting the network connections between the relevant computers in Target's system and the POS devices. Doing this enabled the attackers to install Captosha. Exfiltrating. Even though PCI-compliant merchants like Target encrypt credit card data at the point of sale, most POS devices very briefly store the data, unencrypted, in local RAM, random access memory. Captosha exploits this fleeting exposure to copy the unencrypted data from a card as it is swiped. The malware then stores that data in free RAM in the POS device. The attackers needed to set up a means of moving the data from this short-term parking to a remote server, from which the aggregated data could ultimately be uploaded to the servers of vpsville.ru, the Moscow-based web hosting service the attackers used. They employed three US-based servers to exfiltrate data from Target's POS devices. This was a multi-stage process carried out incrementally over nearly 2 weeks. Once on the US servers, however, the data was quickly sent to vpsville.ru. Cybercrime as cyber competition. The attackers now had the pie of some 70 million customers and the credit card data of 40 million of those customers. What would they do with it? Brian Krebs, one of the nation's foremost reporters on cybercrime, found out by focusing on the end product of the breach rather than how it began. In December 2013, several banks, most of them small, asked Krebs to investigate a sudden off-the-charts spike in fraud rates using credit cards from their institutions. Krebs logged onto a website well known in the fraudster community that sells stolen credit cards. The site announced having received a huge shipment of cards. Krebs quickly matched the bank identification numbers, bins of the advertised cards, with cards issued by the banks who had engaged him. He took this information to the banks and told them how they could go to the website and use bitcoins, a currency often used for illicit online transactions because it is both untraceable and unrecoverable, to buy some of the cards back. He then asked the banks to determine if the cards had a common point of purchase. The banks reported that all the cards had been used at Target between Thanksgiving and December 15, 2013. With this discovery, the plot unraveled. Card shops, also called dump shops, operate on the web much like any other online business. The biggest difference is that the merchandise they offer is exclusively stolen. They present their merchandise in a customer-friendly manner, for example, allowing buyers to select by BIN, type of card, MasterCard, Visa, and so on, expiration date, country, and name of issuing financial institution. They don't sell cards physically stolen from banks or stores. They sell the data copied from those cards. Theirs is a 100% online business. Purchasers click on their desired dumps, download the data from the shop, and then use it either to clone their own physical cards or to make purchases online without a physical card. Let's ponder this a moment. First, without question, the attackers are criminals, but they operate like ordinary business people. Most of the tools of their trade are purchased off the shelf, and they run their criminal enterprises pretty much as they would run any lawful business. Second, the attackers are either partners with or wholesalers to online sellers of stolen credit card data. The online storefronts they supply use brand names, create graphical logos, make promises to their customers, and even offer money-back guarantees. They are international criminal enterprises, without question, yet in many ways they behave like legitimate retail businesses. These cyber criminals did not simply rob Target and victimize its customers, they competed with the credit card companies, the banks, and the credit card holders. Target, like other targets of criminal cyber breaches, discovered that it was operating not only in a business environment made hostile by rogue hackers, but in a business environment inhabited by particularly aggressive and vicious competitors. And there is even more. Analysis of the code uploaded to Target's system turned up the name Rescator, the alias of a hacker who was also the proprietor of a dump shop operating out of the Black Sea port city of Odessa, Ukraine. Krebs discovered that Rescator had also gone by the name Helkern, which was the alias of an Odessan, 22 years old in 2013, named Andrei Kodyarevsky. While the evidence is strong that Rescator and Helkern Kodyarevsky are one and the same person, it is not definitive. That Kodyarevsky is a hacker is certain, and that he operates out of Ukraine is hardly surprising. Both Ukraine and Russia are notorious sources and centers of global cybercrime. As the attacks on the 2015 to 2016 U.S. presidential campaign and election process, including the hacking of the Democratic National Convention, demonstrate, much of this crime is intimately tied to the Russian government. Action item. The law accurately brands cyber attacks as crimes and the attackers as criminals. Business leaders, however, may be better served by thinking of the attackers as especially ruthless and unethical competitors. Mounting and maintaining an aggressive defense against them requires more than cybersecurity measures. It requires business measures, decisions and policies that involve the entire enterprise. Digital resilience is a whole business strategy. Getting a handle on our networks. As individuals and as businesses, we rely on our digital networks to enable and amplify our greatest strengths. Even as they do this, however, they simultaneously enable and amplify our most dangerous vulnerabilities. Digitally enhanced connectivity is the mother of all double-edged swords. It opens us up to unprecedented levels of opportunity and exposes us to equally unprecedented levels of risk. Were it not for digital networks, Target Corporation would likely consist of no more than a handful of stores if it existed at all. A pickpocket might prey on a random customer, once in a while stealing a wallet. A purse snatcher might make off with the occasional purse. A strong-arm robber might force the cashier to empty her till. Whatever mishap occurred, however, would be local and limited. For both merchant and criminal, a non-networked world offers sharply limited opportunity. Although it had invested handsomely in digital security, Target Corporation came off looking desperately clueless that 2013 holiday season. No offense to Target, but its people were even more in the dark than this step-by-step consideration of the breach suggests. For while Target thought of itself as the victim of a particular criminal attack, it was actually the victim of a global civilization so intensively networked that the most remote lives and destinies, invisible to one another, cross, interact, collide, and embrace every moment of every day. A refrigeration contractor based in Sharpsburg, Pennsylvania, opens an email attachment and infects his computer, which thereby connects the second-largest retailer in America, headquartered in Minneapolis, Minnesota, along with as many as 70 million of its customers, to predatory thieves working out of Odessa, Ukraine, on the other side of the planet. These malefactors may be part of organized crime networks linked to governments in Moscow or Kiev. The cost to Target, banks, and credit card companies added up to hundreds of millions of dollars. The cost to individual customers. By the time Target issued a press release on December 19, 2013, Kelly Warpakowski, age 23, living in Milwaukee, had already been notified by her bank that someone in Russia had spent $900 at an oil company using her card. That very night, the Navy Federal Credit Union alerted Jamie Doyle, a sailor from Chesapeake, Virginia, that he was the victim of fraud. He was at sea, deployed on a Navy warship at the time, but his wife Tracy went shopping the next morning only to discover that her debit card had been drained. "We were literally going in to buy our Christmas dinner and we had no money." Neither Target, nor Kelly, nor Jamie, nor Tracy saw the connections. How could they have? Yet we all need, at the very least, to recognize that the connections exist. In his 2016 book, The Seventh Sense, Power, Fortune, and Survival in the Age of Networks, consultant and author Joshua Cooper Ramo writes how linking our bodies, our cities, our ideas, everything really, together introduces a genuinely new dynamic to our world. It creates hyperdense concentrations of power. It breeds fresh chances for complex and instant chaos. To follow the logic of the French philosopher Paul Virilio for a moment, when you invent the ship, you also invent the shipwreck. When you invent the plane, you also invent the plane crash. Surely we can count on the network to invent the network accident, and many of them. Ramo observes that the pre-network instinct to fear Chinese or fear Spanish is the wrong one. Fear deflation, fear ISIS, fear the RMB, Chinese yuan. Such fear reflects a blindness. Finance, terrorism, and currency change when they are connected. It's the network we should be nervous about. Yes, Target should have been nervous about their network. Yet when they were warned, not once but twice, that intruders were in their house, they did nothing. If an intruder had walked in the front door of a Target store, strolled through a checkout lane, and held up a POS, they would at least have called the cops. Why did they ignore alarms that detected a cyber intruder? According to cybersecurity experts the Daily Mail interviewed in 2014, Target is routinely bombarded with alerts. They get so many that they just don't respond to everything. In fact, as the Daily Mail pointed out, the FireEye software Target used has a function that automatically deletes malicious software, but it had been turned off by Target's security team before the hackers attack. This is what the vast majority of FireEye's users do because there are so many false positives. An automated security system requires love and care and feeding, according to the experts the British newspaper talked to. You have to watch it and monitor it. Watch and monitor. Are we human beings up to the task? In Resilience, Why Things Bounce Back, Andrew Zolli and Anne-Marie Healy write of the incomprehensible complexity, interconnectivity, and volatility of the modern world, one in which upheavals can appear to be triggered by seemingly harmless events, arrive with little warning, and reveal hidden, almost absurd correlations in their wake. As for the contributions of the much ballyhooed information age, just having more data doesn't automatically help. Too many alerts are just as bad as too few. Maybe worse, the IT experts told the Daily Mail. After all, Zolli and Healy continue, if we could actually see each of the individual packets of data pulsing through the internet, could we make sense of them? The answer, which is no,
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.